external ear is the beginning of collection of sound waves. It is important in the process and should be as important as any other part of the hearing process. The hearing process is very important, and some people lose part of the hearing process and they use hearing aids. This is a case of lacerated pinna of the ear or the external ear, and it's important to be able to know simple features so that one can repair this ear in a reasonable way. One common way of injuring the tympanic membrane through inserting cotton buds into the external auditory meatus, and if you are not aware, then it is going to be very easily severing the tympanic membrane. This is a mild deformed pinna of the external ear, and this part of the external ear is developed from 6 tubercles, 3 from the first branchial arch and 3 from the second branchial arch. This little hole at the tip of the arrow is a very simple congenital abnormality of forming the pinna of the ear. This is the pinna of the ear probably after a trauma where most of it is lacerated, and therefore it is not viable to be kept, and it has been excised. There are artificial external ears that can be fitted for this patient. Blood coming through the external auditory meatus into the pinna of the ear is a very dangerous sign. It may indicate fracture of the skull. Therefore, it should be taken very seriously. This is an insect stuck in the external auditory meatus. These things happen. This is a view of the external auditory meatus, and if the doctor, for example, taking the insect out, if he has no anatomical knowledge of the external auditory meatus, the doctor will damage and causes lots of problems in the external auditory meatus. If there is an inflammation or damage to the external auditory meatus, the result of the inflammation is constriction of the external auditory meatus, which is going to affect the process of hearing. Introducing a forceps into the external auditory meatus to extract wax also requires very good knowledge of anatomy of the external auditory meatus. Otherwise, damage will result. Pus coming out of the external auditory meatus is also a very bad sign. It is a sign of infection, most probably in the middle ear, which has ruptured the tympanic membrane after filling the tympanic cavity of the middle ear, and the pus will come out. This is a serious condition. This is bad, irregular, ugly lesion. It is a basal cell carcinoma, and it is very important in this case to know the draining lymph nodes of this area. Tumors can develop in different parts of the pinna of the external ear. There is widespread redness and swelling of the different features of the pinna of the ear. The pinna of the ear is made of elastic cartilage. Now, inflammation of cartilage is a difficult and serious problem. This is a view through the oroscope going into the external auditory meatus, showing the hair follicles which are there to trap foreign bodies and dirt, but there is a boil in this part of the external auditory meatus. This is going to be very painful because the skin in this area is very adherent to the underlying tissue and pus cannot expand, therefore it is going to be under pressure, causing lots of pain. A swelling coming out from the roof of the external auditory meatus. In this area, tumors can happen. What is the most medial blocked end of the external auditory meatus? It is the tympanic membrane. Tympanic membrane should be shiny and it has special features which we will see in few moments, and this is whitish and looks thick. This tympanic membrane, although it is showing an irregular size of a cone of light reflection, but it also shows invasion of the tympanic membrane with blood vessels. These are signs of inflammation of the tympanic membrane, the most medial structure of the external auditory meatus. This is a closer view at the tympanic membrane, where it is obvious that it is having a hole and showing parts of the middle ear. This is very bad because the tympanic membrane will stop vibrating. Another case of tympanic membrane problems, there is a little hole with redness around it. That means it is traumatic, and there is another hole with irregular margins, and there is invasion of blood vessels into the tympanic membrane. This is a bad inflamed perforated tympanic membrane. This view of the oroscope through the external auditory meatus, where there is total loss of the tympanic membrane, showing features of the middle ear. Some crazy people would like to change the shape of the pinna of the external ear. Some people have very strange ideas about the use of their lobule of the pinna of the ear. this is a view of the pinna of the ear. It has several features classified as elevations and depressions. The outer elevation is called the helix. The inner elevation, parallel almost to the outer helix, is the antihelix, extending upwards. The antihelix will give a branch going anteriorly, and it is the inferior crus. Then we have the tragus that is covering the anterior part of the external auditory meatus, and another elevation is the antitragus on the opposite side of the tragus. Then we have the downward hanging piece of soft tissue. This is called the lobule. Here are the parts of the pinna of the ear, which are elevations and depressions on a real pinna of the ear. That's the helix, the outer elevation, the antihelix, the inner parallel to the helix, it is the antihelix going up and sending an inferior crus. Here is a depression between the antihelix and the crus. It's called triangular fossa. It's a depression, and there is a helix crus coming from anterior, going down and posteriorly to the concha. Here is the antitragus, intertragus notch, and this is the tragus, and this is the lobule. Now, to have a look at the external auditory meatus, doctors use an instrument called the horoscope. This horoscope is introduced at the beginning of the external auditory meatus, but there is a problem. The external auditory meatus is not straight, and the end of the external auditory meatus is the tympanic membrane. Therefore, in adults, the pinna of the ear has to be pulled up and posteriorly to slightly straighten up the external auditory meatus. This is what you start to see at the beginning of the external auditory meatus. There are hair follicles to trap dust and dirt. These are two views of the right and left tympanic membranes, a normal tympanic membranes, and you can see that they are transparent, and you can see through them the ossicles of the middle ear. There are no invading blood vessels, and there is an important landmark, which is the cone of light. On the right, it is at 5 o'clock. If you consider the circle as a clock, and you can see it is nice and shiny. And on the left, it is at 7 o'clock. These are parts of the tympanic membrane. At the periphery, it is thickened because it sits in a groove between the external and the middle ear, and this is called the annulus. And most of the tympanic membrane is tense, and part of it is flaccid. The flaccid is superior, and on both sides of the flaccid area there are anterior fold and a posterior fold. This is the handle of the malleus, middle ear ossicle, attaches to the tympanic membrane and pushes it to the inside, and this depression is called the umbu. And here is the triangular cone of light. This is a normal tympanic membrane, and one has to be used to seeing normal tympanic membranes so that he can recognize bad ones. This is a CT scan of the skull, and it shows that the outer part of the external auditory meatus is pointing backwards. This is a CT scan of the temporal bone, the petrous part, and shows the sinuous, meaning the stretched S-shaped external auditory meatus. This is first part, and then turns and changes direction and points out posteriorly. This is a CT scan of petrous part of the temporal bone, and you can see on the far left the pinna of the ear and the sinuous external auditory meatus. And when you go medially, you find the tympanic membrane. The tympanic membrane here is shown to face forward. This is a CT scan of the skull, and this structure inside the yellow triangle is the petrous part of the temporal bone. You can see that this is the external auditory meatus, and this is the tympanic membrane, the medial border, and this is the cavity of the middle ear. While on the right side of the patient, you can see that the external auditory meatus is filled with fluid or pus, and even the middle ear is filled with some sort of fluid or pus. Tympanic membrane, of course, has been ruptured, and there's a collection of the fluid in the external auditory meatus. This is a section showing the middle ear and the medial part of the external auditory meatus, and here is the bony groove that the tympanic membrane is sitting in. image showing us that the probe is inserted into a heel skull, into the external auditory meatus, therefore points backward. And when we put an oroscope, we have to direct it forward so that they will be in straight line. In this diagram showing the pinna of the ear, the external auditory meatus, and tympanic membrane making its medial border, and the external auditory meatus is made by cartilage on its outer side and bone on its inner side. The bony part of the external auditory meatus is made by the tympanic plate of temporal bone. Another view, a basal one, of the petrous part of the temporal bone showing the tympanic plate making the bony part of the external auditory meatus. The pinna of the ear has intrinsic and extrinsic muscles. These are vestigial in human beings, but very pronounced in animals, which can turn around their external ears, although some people can move their ears. This is the tympanic plate of temporal bone making the bony part of the external auditory meatus, and here is the facial nerve coming in contact with this tympanic plate. This image shows that the dotted area is supplied by the facial nerve. The facial nerve is not purely motor. It has little area supplying the skin, and here it is the area supplying the skin, as if you put your finger behind your ear lobule. This is a plan of nerve supply of the external ear, the pinna of the ear. The nerve supply of the lower part, anterior and posterior, is coming from the greater auricular nerve, superficial nerve of the cervical plexus, and here is the auricular branch of mandibular division of trigeminal, and here is the lesser occipital branch of cervical plexus as well. Another plan of nerve supply of the pinna of the ear. This area is supplied by the auricular branch of vagus nerve. One has to take care not to overstimulate this area, because if you do, then the vagus will be overstimulated and the heart rate will slow down. Now you know which nerve supply is going to supply this green area. It's the auricular branch of the vagus called Arnold nerve. Why should we take care about the vagus nerve supply of the external ear? It is because overstimulation of this skin area may result into vasovagal attack. the pinna of the ear has good